Morgen, liebe Geschwister, liebe Freunde. Seid ganz herzlich gegrüßt mit dem Frieden Gottes hier von der Eben-Ezer Mennonitengemeinde aus Abbotsford. Heute wird in der westlichen Welt Vatertag gefeiert. Wir als Gemeinde haben drei Gottesdienste für den Vatertag geplant. Für den 13., den 20. und den 27. Juni, damit alle Eben-Ezer Mitglieder und Freunde an einem Gottesdienst teilnehmen können. Heute strahlen wir den Hauptteil des Gottesdienstes aus, den wir am vorigen Sonntag, den 13. in unserer Kirche feierten. Der Herr segne dich in deiner Andachtszeit und in deiner Anbetungszeit. In diesem Gottesdienst.
God's peace with each one of us. Good morning, liebe Geschwister, and a warm welcome to this Father's Day celebration service. It is a blessing to be able to worship together in this building. Yet, it feels strange, I might say weird. It feels strange to sit 6 feet apart. It feels strange to see you with your masks. It feels strange to come to a worship celebration service with the instruction not to sing. But this is what we do. This is how we behave, because we believe these government rules are restrictive, yet they are not compromising our faith in Jesus. They're not in direct opposition to the instructions that Jesus himself has left us, and we have it in Scripture. And Scripture instructs us to obey the authorities, and so we will follow the rules to the best of our abilities, even though some of the rules do not make sense to us. But we want to honor Jesus, and that's why we follow these instructions. And so I invite all of us to listen to Scripture from Psalm 103. I'll read some verses from this passage. This is God's word. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. As for men, his days are like grass. He flourishes like a flower of the field. The wind blows over it, and it is gone, and its place remembers it no more. But from everlasting to everlasting, the Lord's love is with those who fear him, and his righteousness with their children's children, with those who keep his covenant and remember to obey his precepts. This is God's word. We want to bow now and pray to our gracious God. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for your empowering presence. We thank you that you treat each one of us with love and compassion. We have come to worship you today. We have come today to declare that we love you, and we are able to do so because you loved us first. We have come today because we have needs, and we know you can give us what we need. Thank you for your presence in our lives. And thank you also for your presence in this gathering, in this building. Receive our worship to you and bless each one of us who are here and each one of us who will join us later online. In Jesus' name we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. And now I'll invite Pastor Reese and his team to present some of the songs.
I'm reading Proverbs 2, verses 1 to 11, the moral benefits of wisdom. My son, if you accept my words and store up my commands within you, turning your ear to wisdom and applying your heart to understanding, indeed, if you call out for insight and cry aloud for understanding, and if you look for it as for silver and search for it as for hidden treasure, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. For the Lord gives wisdom. From his mouth come knowledge and understanding. He holds success in store for the upright. He is a shield to those who walk in whose walk is blameless, for he guards the course of the just and protects the ways of his faithful ones. Then you will understand what is right and just and fair, every good path. For wisdom will enter your heart, and knowledge will be pleasant to your soul. Discretion will protect you, and understanding will guard you.
Father's Day is a great time for us to think about our physical fathers and our mothers, our parents, and also our spiritual fathers, those people who invested in us and taught us. More than 30 years ago, Steve Green wrote a beautiful song called Find Us Faithful. And I hope that as we sing this song for you, and the words will be on the screen, that you will be able to reflect not only on the people who poured into you, but on the importance that you carry and the importance that you have in the long line of faithful followers of Jesus.
We're pilgrims on the journey of the narrow road, and those who've gone before us light the way, cheering on the faithful, encouraging the weary, that lies a stirring testament to God's sustaining grace. Surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let's run the race not only for the prize, but as those who've gone before us, let us leave to those behind us the heritage of faithfulness passed on through godly have come and gone, and our children sift through all we've left behind. May the clues that they discover and the memories they uncover become the light that leads them to the road we each must find. Oh, may
Marian asked me to share a few words about an example I have of my dad that the impact that he made on my life. Sadly, he is no longer with us, but one of the things I remember most about him was his commitment to his wife through his marriage vows. Life was not easy for him in his latter years. My mother battled dementia the last 10 years or so of her life, and my dad suffered numerous health issues of his own during that time. There could have been many reasons for him to give up and to move his wife into an extended care facility, but he didn't. He knew that it meant that they would be separated, and that wasn't what he had promised her on their wedding day so many years ago. His commitment to her meant that it was for life, through good and bad times. In the end, the only thing that separated them was their final admission into VGH, about a week apart. As the years pass and my own memories of my dad and mom start to fade, I am reminded of the commitment my dad made to his wife, and it encourages me to do the same in my own life. As a husband and parent, I fail often. But looking back at their commitment to one another has helped me work harder in my own relationships. Because of his example, anything less is not an option. This is my story. But I also know that not everyone has had a positive relationship with their father. And my hope is that there was someone who has made a positive impact. Thank you.
We will listen to another song and then we'll listen to the message today. Let us pray. Our Father who art in heaven, we worship your holy name. We long for the time when your kingdom becomes more visible in this world we are living in today. We want to do your will. Give us wisdom and courage to do so. We pray for our brothers and sisters who cannot come to the worship service here because of their age or because of their health challenges. And so today we pray for those that we carry in our hearts and also that we put in our bulletin. We pray for Trudy Croker and Mary Enns, who had surgeries. And you are our Savior, you are our Highland. And so we ask that your healing presence may be tangible in their lives so that every day, but especially today, they will sense your presence, which will take away the pain that surgeries have brought. We also pray for Susanna Klassen in her new home, in an old folks' home, that she will be able to adapt. And we pray for Betty Nickel and Victor Dick and Gerhard Friesen and Helen Schultz, Betty Kraus and Gerhard Gerbrandt. We also thank you for your healing presence in the life and the body of Uwe Stahl and pray for his extended family, for Hedwig and Uwe, so that they will have strength to wait upon you till complete healing has happened. We thank you also for providing for each one of us and for this church. And we thank you also for so many faithful, generous servants that you have in this congregation. We have come to glorify your name. In Jesus' name, amen.
The song Ancient Words was written as a summoning song, a song calling God's people to come and ready their hearts and their minds to hear what God is saying through his word, and to make the decision ahead of time to submit, that when our will comes into contest with what the Bible is preaching, that we are the ones that must bend. We live in a time where we believe that we are God's and everything should bend to us. So this is a very important song with a very important message. And I encourage each and every one of us, as we prepare ourselves for what Pastor Ron is going to share, that we would get ready to hear what God is saying and make the decision ahead of time that we will submit to it. If you are a follower of Jesus, you've already made this commitment, but we have to do this over and over again in order for it to be real in our lives. So we're going to sing the song, Ancient Words.
Ancient words, long preserved for our walk in this world. Down with God's own heart, oh, let the ancient words impart. Words of life, words of hope, give us strength, help us cope. In this world, where'er we roam, ancient words will guide us home. Ancient words. Changing me and changing you, we have come,
with open hearts, so let the ancient words impart.
Words of truth, words of light, guide our steps in this light. In the darkness shining clear, ancient words will draw us near. Holy words of our faith, handed down to this age, come to us through sacrifice, only the faithful words of Christ.
Ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts, oh let the ancient words impart. Ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts, oh let the ancient words impart.
Good morning. Father's Day was celebrated when a young woman, first celebrated when a young woman, wanted to honor her dad. In May of 1909, Sonora Smart Dodd of Spokane, Washington, sat in a church service listening to a Mother's Day sermon. And she decided she wanted to designate a day for her dad, William Jackson Smart. She wanted to recognize the faithfulness and strength of her father in raising her and her five brothers as a single parent. So what is it that we wish to celebrate or recognize on this day? What characteristics do we look for in a father? And for this, we're going to look at a passage in 1 Kings chapter 2:2-4, in which David gives his final charge to his son Solomon just before he is about to die. Reading from 1 Kings chapter 2:2-4. "I'm about to go the way of all the earth," he said. "So be strong, act like a man, and observe what the Lord requires. Walk in obedience to him and keep his decrees and commands, his laws and regulations, as written in the law of Moses. Do this so that you may prosper in all that you do and wherever you go, and that the Lord may keep his promise to me. If your descendants watch how they live, and if they faithfully walk before me with all their heart and strength, you will never fail to have a successor on the throne of Israel." Fathers, when the time comes for you and I to die, what word of instruction will you give to your children, to my children? What final word will we pass on to them that they will hear because of the way that we have lived and because of what the Lord has promised each of us? What kind of inheritance will we pass on to the next generation that will be truly lasting? And while I specify fathers in my message, the lesson from today's scripture are there for all of us. They can be applied to everyone. Today, fathers, it's going to be your focus. As well, I know that most of us fathers here, our fathering days are over, except for you, Reese. And our children are probably having their children, and maybe their children are having their children. Or you may be a single person, or you may be a couple that don't have children. Or maybe you have siblings with children. All of us have friends and neighbors with children. Our role in this situation is our interest in them as they raise their children, as they pray for them, and as we pray for them, and God hears our prayers, and he knows our concern and interest for all those around us. Now, where Marion and I live, we live on a street. There's two streets. There's the main street, and then there's another little street coming off of it. And there's about 20 houses on those two streets. And both of them end with dead ends. We have some 20 children playing on those two streets, and two more coming. They're playing the basketball, the hockey, riding their bikes and their scooters. Many have God-fearing parents, grandparents. The oldest among us is well into her 80s, deeply loves the Lord and her community, and is deeply concerned for everyone that's there. Those of us who can't mow their lawns have other people do that for them freely, gladly. When we pass each other on the street, we greet each other, little acts of kindness and love. This is what God intended for our community. Now, David was about to go the way in which all of us are to go, should the Lord tarry. He was about to die, and he had reigned for some 40 years. God had blessed him on every side. And the key promise that God had given him was that his family would never fail to have a successor on the throne should his successors keep the basic charge that he was about to give Solomon. We all know well the story of Solomon, how his mother Bathsheba, with whom David had an adulterous relationship, and David also had Uriah, her husband, killed in battle. Child from that relationship died, and when David was confronted by the prophet Nathan, he repented. And then he continued with Bathsheba, and Solomon came out of that. And David promised Bathsheba that this son would be king after him. And David now challenged Solomon with four steps that ultimately would bring about the prosperity for him and all those that followed. And the first of these steps speaks more directly to his character. The other three relate more directly to Solomon's relationship to God. And I see within this fourfold challenge four basic principles for all fathers, and in essence, all of us, whatever stage of life we're at. The first step David says to Solomon, he says, be strong, act like a man. Well, Solomon was a man. Why would he need this reminder? Well, there's nothing in our text that specifically relates to this. Solomon is possibly not a man of physical strength, certainly not like his father David. David was obviously a man of significant physical strength as well as character. He had confronted lions and Goliaths, led his men in numerous successful wars. David was not a man to be afraid of facing difficult challenges. Solomon was possibly a person who was hesitant. And so David, knowing this, gives him a challenge that he knows he will need in his role as a king, to act with determination, with firmness. Now, we're not going to attempt to deal with a question of gender equality with this statement, but what I believe David is challenging Solomon to do is to take charge. Do not hesitate to take the initiative in difficult issues. Face those challenges head on. As I said, with strength, with courage, or another would be to be steadfast. And if you continue to read what happens immediately following in the story of Solomon, in a number of instances, Solomon does exactly that. He is faced with difficult choices, and he acts with wisdom, firmness, and his kingdom is further established. You, as fathers, are men. God has entrusted you with a challenge. The need for strength is not so much physical strength, but moral and spiritual character. This is the strength that is needed to be developed. Our bodies may not be the type when properly exercised we develop physically, but there is a strength that every person can develop, and that is of spiritual character. When we know something is wrong, we do not hesitate to act. We face the sin in any form, first of all, in our own lives, and then also in the life of our family. When we're tempted with wrong, we confront it for what it is. We turn from it. When we see obedience, we encourage. We're grateful. We act decisively. Secondly, he says, observe what the Lord requires. To observe means to notice something and to acknowledge it as being significant. Solomon was to take seriously what God was asking of him in his role as a king over his people. He was to give wise leadership. You as a father are to notice and take seriously what are those important responsibilities you have as your role as a parent. Well, what are some of those roles? Let me remind you of just three areas that I believe are most important that we as fathers are to observe from Scripture. First and foremost, we are to recognize that God, our Father, sets the example of what it being a father is all about. He deeply loves us and cares for us. He forgives us. He asks us to love him with everything that we have. We are to set the example to our children of our devotion to him. Recall the words of David from our text, to walk faithfully before me with all our heart and soul. Our children are to see our devotion and love for God and our priority we place in our lives for him. Second, we are to love our wives. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Eric just gave us an example of that. What will give the greatest sense of peace and security for our children? Will it not be that their parents deeply love and support each other? We know that one of the major reasons we have a breakdown in society is when families fall apart. Children are left adrift and feel abandoned, thus creating a vacuum in which evil can set in. God created marriage for husband and wife to be one for life. They are to demonstrate the principle and of the unity and the oneness of God. Fathers, love your children's mother. Give yourself to her and support her. God will be honored, and your family will be blessed. A third point under this is that we are to train our children. Proverbs 22, verse 6 says, train up your child in the way that he or she should go. The primary teacher of our child is not the school. You as a father are to take very deliberate role in directing your children's learning in the primary understanding of what life is all about. Now, this does not mean to say that they can't go to public school for the learning of the three R's, reading, writing, and arithmetic. The teaching that Scripture is pointing to is where the moral and spiritual character of our child is developed. Now, it may be that because in this day, the public schools are more and more trying to attempt to usurp our role as parents in determining their character, our children's character, that we choose to send our children to private school or to homeschool. But the bottom line still remains that our role as parents in establishing moral and spiritual character remains ours. It's our responsibility to train our children. We are the ones to set the curriculum, not the school, not the government, but us. Our third step is to walk in obedience. Doctors and health officials tell us the vital importance of walking daily, getting our physical exercise to get our heart and our blood flowing. The same exercise is needed in our spiritual life as we step by step, as our text speaks of, walk in obedience, where we recognize areas in our life that requires change. We correct our life patterns so that we align ourselves to God's word. And that will mean that we will have to discipline to correct our children. Proverbs 13:24 says, if a person does not punish his children, he does not love them. But the person who loves his child is careful to correct them. I like the way Paul puts it. 1 Timothy 3:4, see that your children obey and do so in a manner worthy of full respect. What that simply means is that when we correct our children, they recognize that their correction comes from someone who has learned that lesson that we are trying to teach them. If we do one thing and attempt to teach another, our children will see that double standard and hold us in contempt and ultimately will not respect us. This results in them often choosing not to obey us. And we, out of our guilt for not holding on to what we know is to be right, we accommodate to that disobedience. When we as parents are able to share with our children some of the lessons that we have learned and how we have grown through that, our children learn from those occasions, and they learn to respect us through that. This is where firmness of character is needed in setting the direction for our children. Our last point reiterates the previous two, but with a slightly different emphasis. Keep his decrees, meaning don't get diverted from what God has called you to do. We all know what our ultimate goal is. Our goal is to raise God-fearing children whose heart and soul is set to follow Jesus. This is our goal. That's our focus. But if we veer off to one side or to the other, we know what's going to happen. We're going to miss the mark. God has placed his decrees, his word, for us, for our own good. He's created us in such a way that keeping with them, it first of all glorifies God and ultimately benefits us. We will be blessed. The immediate neighborhood in which Marion and I live recently had 4 young families that were attracted to our specific area. And I believe they came for that particular reason. They recognized that those that lived there lived by the decrees of God, and they also wanted to live under that and be blessed by that. They may not have specifically said this, but they recognized that there was something that being in that neighborhood that stood out, and they wanted to be a part of it. They wanted their children to grow in that environment. Going back to the story of our text, we know that the end of result of Solomon is that initially he followed his father with these fourfold injunction. He demonstrated strength of character in following and asking and receiving wisdom. He observed what the Lord required in walking in God's ways. He kept his decrees. As a result, many of the proverbs that are found written in the book of Proverbs, they are attributed to him. The book, the Song of Solomon, is also attributed to him. He fulfilled his father's aim, and that was to build a temple to God for his people to worship in. He was a man who was honored for his wisdom from far and wide. God also blessed him with great abundance, but we also know that towards the end of his reign, he allowed himself to be diverted from God's word. He did not keep all of God's decrees. He permitted his foreign wives to build places of worship to their gods. He accommodates them by worshiping with them. And this ultimately sets the stage for his son to make foolish choices, resulting in the nation being divided. Later, kings bring about the nation's exile. And the story in that land, in some ways, is still playing itself out even as we speak. The true strength of fatherhood, as well as any person, lies first and foremost in our relationship with God. God created us for this reason, and out of that relationship comes a willingness to observe what Scripture says and to walk in those ways. In keeping with these, God promises that we will be blessed. We will see our subsequent generations of our children grow in their relationship to God. This is what fathers are to pass on to their children, and they to theirs. Now may God bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you and give you the peace of heart that comes as you give with all your strength and observe his ways, walking in obedience and keeping those decrees so that your children, grandchildren, and all those children in your lives will come to know Jesus and give themselves to him with all their heart. Amen.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil he doth richly repay. Not a grief nor a loss, not a frown nor a cross, but is blessed if we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. But we never can prove the delights of his love until all on the altar we lay. For the favor he shows and the joy he bestows are for those who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet, we will sit at his feet, or we'll walk by his side in the way. What he says we will do, where he sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Der Herr segne dich.
The Lord bless you.
Und der Herr behüte dich.
The Lord keep you.
Der Herr lasse sein Antlitz leuchten.
The Lord make his face shine on you.
Und sei dir gnädig.
And be gracious to you.
Der Herr erhebe sein Angesicht auf dir.
The Lord turn his face toward you.
Und schenke dir seinen göttlichen Frieden.
And give you peace.
Amen.
Amen.